Hey everyone, thanks for coming out and spending some time with me on one of our favorite topics at Criteo, agentic commerce. We'll talk a little bit about today of some of our perspectives on what will be and a few things that might not be. You know, I was looking over the presentation and it struck me, there's a lot of A words in this presentation. There's agentic, assisted, augmented, always on, my new favorite A word, ambient, and a word that I'm a little bit skeptical about, autonomous. But we'll unpack that. Look, so we are in the biggest transformation since the dot-com era. It's affecting infrastructure, application layer, user behavior. It is a great time to be in this business. It reminds me of the beginning of my career helping to launch the e-commerce site for a leading retailer. People running around trying to figure out how things are going to work, making predictions about user behavior, thinking about new technology standards. It is just a great, great time to be in this business. But as we all work together in that collective dialogue to figure out how things are going to work, we get a few predictions right, we get a few predictions wrong, and then as Bill Gates reminded us some 15, 20 years ago when this quote came out, we oftentimes get the timing wrong. We tend to overestimate the amount of change in the near term and underestimate the amount of time in the long term. And so it's an apropos sort of grounding as we start to dig into the space. So first prediction of the presentation. End-to-end shopping experience will not happen in only one platform, right? We at Criteo are not big believers in monoculture. And you can see this borne out in the lessons of history of the last 30 years in the digital ecosystem. The pattern is one of fragmentation and addition, not of consolidation or elimination, right? Or said simply, we tend to add more digital channels and touch points, not replace them. And we think that agentic will be one of those channels, maybe the most powerful one that we've had since the digital ecosystem started evolving 30 years ago, but one of several. And just to keep us grounded in some of the facts that I think are important to remember, let's take a look at retail sales and e-commerce and the relationship between them. When I was starting my career launching that e-commerce site, there were forecasts and predictions that e-commerce would cannibalize all of brick-and-mortar retail, or maybe half of it, right? There were sort of draconian scenarios being thrown around. It's a sobering statistic that e-commerce is 20% of retail sales today. Like, how is that? It's a surprisingly small number for something that a lot of us as practitioners spend a lot of time around. And there's two interesting sub-facts sort of underneath that. One, the growth rate of e-commerce is still double brick and mortar, right? So 6% versus 3% in one of the last studies I saw for the kind of next couple of years, which I find interesting. And it's sort of testimony to the growth of the channel inside the overall segment. The other lesson, not shown here necessarily, is that the overall category grew. And the lesson there is that these technology phenomena are not zero-sum games, right? E-commerce gave rise to omni-channel retailing. That grew the whole sector of retail incrementally, right? So while there was share shift and cannibalization, there was incremental gain for the category. That's extremely important as we try to predict winners, losers, market sizes in the agentic commerce world. So let's take a look at how that world is starting to evolve. Right, so if you study sort of adoption and use case behavior in agentic platforms today, you see an overwhelming use of upper funnel use cases. So really what these agentic platforms have unlocked is discovery and complex problem solving, which is a good example of product market fit. As soon as there became a conversational interface to LLMs, we instantly unlocked what had been two major friction points in the digital ecosystem up till then. And that's where you get massive adoption. It's a good reminder that consumers will flock to best-in-class user experience that unlock friction points in customer journeys or just general behavior. And that's why you see those really high percentages at the top of the funnel. Now you see lower percentages at the bottom of the funnel. And what that shows you is that these platforms have yet to achieve product market fit for mid and lower funnel use cases like consideration and purchase. And that's borne out in the sort of survey feedback that you can go out and get. It's a high level of trust and belief in the efficacy of upper funnel use cases, and not as much in the lower end, right? And these statistics are actually an outcome of product development, not necessarily an input, because people gravitate to best-in-class experience very quickly. So what do you do if you're one of those leading platforms? Well, you introduce a new product that solves that need. And so OpenAI Instant Checkout launched a few weeks ago and had just a blue chip roster of brands sign up to be a part of that immediately. Etsy, Shopify, Walmart, DoorDash, just to name a few. And so what does everybody get out of this new platform? Well, as users, right, we get the opportunity to sort of research and have a seamless sort of transaction in a single sort of workflow. If you're the merchants, you're making a bet that this is incremental demand that's additive to your traffic and to your shopper count. ChatGPT takes a small transaction fee. It's actually not a huge revenue generator at the outset. And the merchants don't actually get any data flow other than a product order, right? So it really is about incrementality of demand. But we'll start to get into this a little bit later. For OpenAI, it's the beginning of starting to get a transactional data feed, which is really important for building out those lower and mid-funnel use cases, right? There's some data and algorithmic build-out that needs to happen, and I will get into a few slides and try to unpack that for us. Back to the monoculture topic, it's worth remembering that some other very big companies have made attempts to get their arms around end-to-end shopping, and it hasn't worked that well, right? So Meta pulled back on their checkout in June of this year, and Google deprecated the buy on Google functionality back in 2023, right? So the lessons of history are important to remember. So another prediction, Gen AI and agentic platforms won't evolve without the right commerce data and consumer trust, right? So there's this concept of LLMs needing to merge or be integrated with recommendation systems that power commerce platforms to power the use cases that build trust in the use cases in the mid and lower funnel. I'll share my personal bike tire purchasing story. I drove my team crazy with this example over the summer. So I live in New York City. I'm a cyclist. And that means that there's two kinds of pavement that I ride on, bad pavement and worse pavement. So I'm in the market for new bike tires. So I spend a good hour with my assistant querying sort of puncture-proof, high-quality, durable, but also that fit the specs of my bike. And I got a carousel that sort of looked something like this. And while the problem-solving part of that was quite useful, the actual choices that were available and the quality of the feed was quite poor. So there was no way I was going to be able to make a transaction even one step off-site from that. There were broken links, product information was incomplete, availability wasn't there. No way you could sort of transact on that. I ended up going to my local bike store, walked in maybe a little more informed than I normally would have been, and bought from someone that I trust, right? And that's a pretty typical consumer journey in a lot of categories today. So it's a good example of that lower funnel that needs work and that instant checkout is trying to address. And it gets to the point that agentic platforms are great conversationalists. That's how they're built. They are large language models at the end of the day. But to get recommendations right, you need data, right? Data that comes from transaction feeds that happen on large scale over periods of time that create graphs and really like deterministic outcomes of what people were shown, the context of which it happened, and ultimately what they did, what they clicked, what they scrolled, what they bought. And so that gets us to sort of one of the core premises here, which is how do these algorithmic platforms come together, right? The LLMs will be the front end, the great conversationalists, right? Help you understand the problem that you're trying to solve, help you dissect it, narrow it down. But ultimately, when it starts to get to something that requires product information, it needs to go out to a recommendation system that's built on commerce data, that actually has the ability to narrow that down with up-to-date data feeds for availability, return information, sales rank, price, brand or retailer-approved copy and imagery. And then that returns to the LLM to sort of complete the packaging of that output. And this at Criteo is how we see the future of this sort of underpinning happening. And once this gets going, I think you'll see rapid adoption, or it certainly opens up use cases for sort of consideration and certainly for commerce in the future. And here's an example brought to life. The Criteo Global Catalog actually has 4.5 billion SKUs in it. And all of those are kept up to date real time every day by live retail and brand feeds. So little fun fact, there are 150 handheld vacuum cleaners in that database. I actually looked this up. And it's also interesting that the way that we determine what a handheld vacuum cleaner is involves a process called normalization, because handheld is sort of a subjective term, right? We all would have at least a concept of what that means, but we might have slightly different definitions. And out of 4.5 billion SKUs, there are vacuum cleaners that have handles that are not necessarily handheld. And so you need this normalization routine to narrow down to the 150 that meet the conventional definition of handheld. But the bonus that you get is the output that you get from an agentic platform today is on the left. Might show items that are out of stock, items that have high return rates, even items that are discontinued. And what you get when you include a catalog feed like our SKU catalog, normalized, you get in-stock information. You get it narrowed down from the 150. We actually know that there's 50 that really matter, because the bottom 50 have been discontinued, the middle 50 have sort of availability or return issues, and there's really a universe even within that that you should be sort of building your recommendations from. And that's incredibly useful when we're talking about the type of scale of querying and transactions that needs to happen to make this all work. Another prediction. Agentic platforms will elevate retail media, not replace it. And this really goes back to the monoculture point that I made earlier. We as shoppers and consumers, we actually like to move around, and we find value in the equity and context of shopping environments, whether that's brands that we're comfortable with, retailers that we're comfortable with. And you can see that in the traffic patterns today, right? While there is some decline in publisher traffic from zero-click searches, there's very little decline in e-commerce traffic, which goes back to sort of the adoption of the mid and lower funnel that we were talking about earlier. So we see this paradigm of retail e-commerce as you know it today being better informed by the discovery front end in agentic platforms being incredibly durable. And with that, the opportunity to advertise and interact with sponsored listing, that will continue in a retail environment for many years to come. And that's what those merchants see that signed up to instant checkout. Walmart, Etsy, Shopify. They see that as incrementality, and they see instant checkout as another channel, not a replacement for how they attract and retain traffic. Right? Incrementality is the name of the game. The other part that's important is that retailers will need to build up their own agentic front ends, because you don't want to surrender that functionality to a third party. You want to support best-in-class experience on your site, right? That's your right to compete for that traffic and for the beginning of that journey, not just the mid or the end part of it. And so retailer AI assistants and agentic front ends will be incredibly important. That's the new battleground for e-commerce retailing, I think, for the next 5 to 10 years. And we've all come to expect best-in-class experience, as you all know, right? If you have an amazing recommendation experience on Netflix, you expect to have that on Etsy as well. And so we don't differentiate sort of what vertical or category we're in as consumers. We expect best-in-class across every touch point that we interact with. So the path forward on Agentic wouldn't be complete without a little framework slide. There's sort of this pattern of going from research to find to buy to advanced buying, just more complex purchases with higher consideration, maybe more administration involved in them, and then full autonomy. And there's no question, despite the massive user adoption that we see with agents today, we're still at phase one. You know, it really is a research tool, and that's borne out by those high percentages that you saw on the funnel slide at the beginning of the presentation. But it will move quickly, back to the point about underestimating change in the short term and what, underestimating it in the long term. I think we can move over the next couple of years pretty quickly through 2 and 3 if those data and recommendation underpinnings come together the right way. That's what really powers the move from a discovery tool to a consideration and a commerce tool, right? It can move through phases 2 and 3, I think, relatively quickly. I'm not a fan of number 5. We'll wrap this up here at the end with a handful of sort of sum ups. Full autonomy, I just don't buy it. I don't know about you, but maybe I'm control freak in my life. I don't delegate too many things. And things that are low friction, low consideration are solutions looking for problems. And high consideration things actually need your involvement. So I just am a little skeptical of autonomy as it gets thrown around in our sort of industry discourse on the topic. It will be very interesting to see the monetization path for AI platforms. Right, you see glimpses of how they could go down a marketplace path, being the discovery front end for a large part of the e-commerce ecosystem. I actually am not sure if that model is scalable enough to create the revenue opportunity that's needed. And so it'll be really interesting to see how instant checkout fares, and if they move to multi-product basket capabilities or other things like that. But the advertising path is still the most likely path. It's the most scalable, the most durable, and time has shown us time and time again, it eventually becomes a lever that is accepted by users and, in fact, can be quite useful, in fact. And that's the third point. Native advertising needs to be useful and trustful, and it doesn't have to suck. I actually think that there will be ways, if you pipe in the right data, have that tuned by long history and accurate information of what people want, what they do, I think you can create visibility for brands, and just showing up is the ad. It doesn't have to be some flashing banner, right? Visibility in a high traffic environment is the ad. And there is a way to balance sort of user need and objectivity with, I think, an economic angle for brands to sort of be a part of that consideration set. And last but not least, if you take nothing else away from the talk today, know that there's a really interesting technology merge going on sort of under the surface, and that is useful and trusted advertising is derived from high quality commerce data. You cannot have it without that. So you need to have sort of a recommendation engine that has large volume of context, of really tests. What have people been shown? What did they do? How do I process that over time? And that's really what makes for world-class end-to-end digital experiences. So with that, I'm going to wrap us up, and thank you so much for the time. Would love to take questions after the show. Thanks very much.